Welcome back. I think we had a very interesting morning session, very solid. This afternoon session is devoted to the issue of the genocide and reparations. The morning was focused on the treaties. And the first speaker will be Dr. Raymond Kevorkian. And I think I can call him a friend. I hope I am not delusional, but that's my impression. And Professor Kevorkian teaches at the French Institute of Geopolitics at the University of Paris 8, Saint-Denis. He is also the librarian of the Bibliothèque Nubar in Paris, which has an invaluable collection, in particular about all the sources of the Armenian genocide. Professor Kevorkian publishes a journal which is probably the best Armenian historical academic journal I know of over the past 10 to 15 years. It's called Histoire Arménienne Contemporaine, and he is the director and editor-in-chief of that journal. His publications are massive and in very diverse fields, because in his earlier life, Professor Kevorkian was also a librarian at the Bibliothèque Nationale, and he has several skills besides being a historian. I would like to quote just, since we like short introductions here, just some of his recent publications, in particular the translation of his massive volume, Study of the Armenian Genocide, which I can tell you is the best thing available, and the best thing available also probably at the very least for the next decade or more. It's called The Armenian Genocide, A Complete History, published by I.B. Torres. This is the English translation, about 1,000 pages merely, of the French edition, Le Génocide des Arméniens, published by Odile Jacob, 2006. And to name just a second publication among many others, he co-published, along with Vahet Ashtian, A History of the AGBU, the first volume of it, Un siècle de l'Union Générale Arménienne de Bienfaisance, first volume, 1906-1940. And he has many, many other publications that are of very high academic level. It is for me also a real pleasure to welcome Raymond. Unfortunately, he will be speaking in Armenian, but I will serve as his humble translator.
Thank you. Well, donc, je vais aborder cet après-midi devant vous une question assez complexe concernant la spoliation des biens arméniens au moment du génocide arménien.
I am going to address. Can you hear me? This afternoon, I am going to address a quite complex issue. The massive looting, theft, or spoliation of Armenian properties in the Ottoman Empire.
En me concentrant tout particulièrement sur ce qu'on appelait les biens nationaux.
I will focus specifically on what was called national holdings or properties.
Alors, en introduction, il faut d'abord souligner le contexte historique dans lequel cette spoliation a lieu. Et ce contexte historique, il est lié à la volonté jeune turque de bâtir ce qu'ils appelaient une économie nationale.
By way of introduction, I will focus.
Let me tell you, that microphone takes 3 seconds after you turn it on. Okay. It'd be better if you just left it on.
By way of introduction, I will focus on the historical background of this phenomenon, that is the Young Turks' attempt at building what was called then a national economy.
Donc les biens arméniens, c'est un des aspects de capter les biens arméniens, ça constitue un des aspects de cette politique, mais elle est évidemment beaucoup plus large, et une des premières manifestations de cette action, c'est la suppression des capitulations le 1er octobre 1914.
Of course, this policy of massive spoliation was one aspect of the overall policy of the national economy, but one of its first indications, earliest indications, was the abolition of something that was called the capitulations on the 1st of October 1914.
Ces capitulations, elles réglementaient et elles favorisaient un certain nombre de puissances européennes en particulier, qui pouvaient, avec des privilèges, commercer dans le cadre de l'Empire ottoman. D'une certaine manière, ces capitulations avaient une signification impériale très forte. Je veux dire, la Turquie était dans un statut de dépendance considérable sur le plan économique par rapport aux États européens.
These capitulations regulated the trade with a number of European powers which benefited from them, and it was a kind of, I will add this myself, traumatic arrangement for the Ottoman Empire.
Donc, concernant les biens arméniens plus spécifiquement, on connaît assez bien une loi qui date du 26 septembre 1915, mais dans les faits, les premières démarches visant à capter ces biens reposent sur une directive, donc ce n'est pas du tout une loi, qui date du 10 juin 1915.
The process of spoliation was based on a law that was passed on the 26th of September 1915. But actually the process started with a directive, which wasn't a law, of June 10th, 1915.
Donc, c'est sur la base de cette simple mesure administrative que les premières opérations de spoliation ont eu lieu. Précisons que cette directive a été accompagnée de documents secrets, dont maintenant un certain nombre commence à être publié par les historiens turcs.
Secret document complemented this directive, and now some of them are being published by Turkish historians. Up to now they were unknown, they were kept a secret.
Donc il faut souligner que la loi du 26 septembre 1915, qui concerne donc le titre officiel, c'est « Loi provisoire relative aux biens, dettes et créances des personnes qui ont été déportées ».
The name of that law of the 26th of September is Provisional Law relating to the holdings, debts, and creances, which I don't know exactly how to translate, of persons that have been deported.
Alors cette loi, en fait, est adoptée alors que l'essentiel des déportations a eu lieu et que l'essentiel des biens a déjà été capté par l'État ottoman.
This law was adopted, passed, at a time when already the spoliations had taken place and people had been deported. In a nutshell, what Raymond means is that it's an ex post facto law to legitimize, legalize what has already substantially taken place.
Alors, elle est complétée par un décret d'application qui date, lui, du 8 novembre 1915. Instaurant des commissions des Mvali Metruke, c'est-à-dire des commissions chargées, entre guillemets, de gérer ces biens.
This law of September was complemented by a kind of a directive or other law of the 26th of October 1915, establishing commissions of abandoned goods, supposedly abandoned properties, to precisely implement the application of the earlier decree of September 1915.
Alors pourquoi cette loi en quelque sorte rétroactive? Une des thèses qui est avancée par, par exemple, Ilmar Kaiser, qui a dépouillé les archives allemandes à ce sujet, est que la spoliation des biens arméniens a eu une incidence très lourde financière sur des entreprises et des banques allemandes et autrichiennes.
Why is retroactive ex post facto law? One approach is that of historian Ilmar Kaiser, who argues that this legal process was needed because the spoliation of Armenian properties harmed, among others, German and other investments in the Ottoman Empire.
Et il présente pour attester de cela une protestation officielle de l'ambassade allemande à Constantinople, datée du 13 septembre, et qui semble montrer que c'est suite à cette plainte diplomatique que Talat, puisque là c'est clairement lui qui a l'initiative de cette loi, prend l'initiative donc de faire voter cette loi.
As proof of what he's stating, Ilmar Kaiser presents a complaint of the German embassy in the Ottoman Empire, a complaint filed on the 13th of September 1915 about precisely the process of spoliation. And he argues that the law that was passed on the 26th of September was a reaction mostly generated by Talat Pasha, a reaction to this complaint of the German embassy.
Alors, il faut que je vous précise maintenant un peu la nature des biens, en me concentrant en particulier sur les biens immobiliers. Il y a deux principales catégories. Il y a les biens immobiliers qu'on appelle les biens nationaux ou les biens du millet arménien.
I will now focus on the nature of the holdings or properties that were spoliated. They are of two kinds. The first one is the so-called national properties, usually under the jurisdiction of the Patriarchate, and they are mostly real estate type of properties, as they say in French, not mobile.
Alors, ce sont des biens qui ont un statut très connu en monde musulman, c'est ce qu'on appelle les biens waqf.
These are properties that have a particular status in the Muslim world. They are called waqf goods, that is, they belong to some type of religious endowments that makes them theoretically, I believe, immune to capture from the state.
Oui, c'est effectivement des biens inaliénables. Donc, on a un recensement assez précis de ces biens, en tout cas pour ce qui concerne les biens religieux. En l'occurrence, 2538 églises et 451 monastères.
We have a quite detailed description of these national properties. More than 2,500 churches and 451 monasteries. Mais plus their holdings, I mean, because each one of those could have lands around itself, for example, you know?
Alors, cette catégorie, on peut aussi l'observer comme en fait le cœur du patrimoine monumental arménien en Turquie jusqu'à nos jours.
This category of holdings and goods can be considered as actually the Armenian cultural heritage, historical cultural heritage, which happens now to be located in Turkey and spoliated in 1915.
les biens Boiscoeuf comprenaient également toute une série de terrains agricoles, voire de villages entiers, de maisons de rapport, de moulins, de pressoirs, qui avaient été donc légués par des mécènes au cours des siècles et qui étaient tous inscrits donc au titre des biens Boiscoeuf et qui constituaient un revenu annuel considérable pour le patriarcat arménien et tous les diocèses de province, à partir duquel, en fait, les dépenses étaient engagées. Ça couvrait une bonne partie des frais de fonctionnement.
These Boiscoeuf properties included, among others, large chunks of agricultural land, sometimes whole villages, windmills, and other such properties that generated income for the Patriarchate of Istanbul or Constantinople, the Armenian Patriarchate, and all that, of course, went to the Turkish state.
Alors, l'autre catégorie de biens immobiliers, évidemment, il s'agit des propriétés personnelles, là, avec un statut beaucoup plus simple, pour lesquels on a potentiellement des capacités de nous documenter à l'avenir.
The other category besides the national properties consisted in the individual personal properties of various individuals, and there the documentation is weaker, but we will learn more with time.
Alors, à ce sujet, en 2005, dans le cadre de la procédure d'adhésion de la Turquie à l'Union européenne, des négociations, un projet a été développé par les autorités turques de numérisation de l'ensemble des registres du cadastre.
Regarding these properties and in the context of Turkey's application to become a member of the European Union, in 2005, a project was put forward by the Turkish government digitize the cadastre, the land property, the map of holdings of Turkey.
Donc, le Conseil de sécurité turc, qui comprend des laïcs et des militaires, même s'il a perdu un petit peu de son influence ces dernières années, s'est fermement opposé à la diffusion publique de ces registres.
The Security Council of Turkey, made up of the military and civilian authorities, opposed such a digitization, and especially the fact that it could be made public for reasons that are not hard to divine. This last part, I am adding it.
Bon, vous avez compris qu'en fait, ces registres permettraient d'identifier les propriétaires de la moindre parcelle de terrain sur l'ensemble de l'Empire ottoman à la veille de la Première Guerre mondiale.
You have understood that these registers, digitized and made public, would allow people to discern who the owner of those property was at the beginning of the First World War, and who, of course, pave the way for potential lawsuits and so on if somebody has steal documents. Again, this last part I am complementing what Dr. Kevorkian said.
Bon, je vais vous épargner les détails de tous les articles de cette loi concernant les biens abandonnés pour me concentrer sur une partie qui est absolument centrale. C'est la gestion des conséquences de cette loi et de cette spoliation pendant la période intercalaire entre l'armistice de Moudros, donc fin octobre 1918, et l'arrivée des Kémalistes au pouvoir en 1923.
I will spare you the details of all the other laws that were enacted during the First World War. There were many. And I will focus on the intermediary period between the armistice of Mudros in October 1918 and the official arrival of the Kemalists in power in 1923. I will take a look at the way these properties were managed, quote unquote, in that period.
Oui, il y avait 33 commissions chargées de la liquidation des biens arméniens. Il y avait toute une procédure qui s'est mise en place. Je pourrais vous dire aussi que les principaux bénéficiaires ont été les cadres des clubs jeunes turcs de province. Mais ça serait beaucoup plus trop long et ça va nous éloigner du sujet.
There were 33 commissions that were supposed to take care of these quote-unquote abandoned properties. I can also tell you that the main beneficiaries of the redistribution of those properties were the members of Young Turkish, that is Committee of Union and Progress clubs in the various provinces of the empire. But that would lead us away from what is perhaps more essential and on which I am going to focus.
Donc, en novembre 1918, les hauts commissaires français et britanniques ont exigé en priorité des nouvelles autorités ottomanes, donc le gouvernement libéral qui a été mis en place, deux mesures rapides, aider au rapatriement des rescapés arméniens et deuxièmement, de permettre la restitution des biens à ces rescapés qui rentraient dans leur foyer.
In November 1918, that is immediately after the armistice of Mudros, which was October the 30th, I believe, 1918, the two high commissioners, the French and British high commissioners in Istanbul, imposed two laws on the government of the Sultan. First, to repatriate the Armenian deportees to their homes, and second, to restitute the properties that had been confiscated or redistributed during the First World War.
Alors, on est particulièrement bien documenté sur cette période et les circonstances, d'une part par les archives du patriarcat arménien de Constantinople, mais d'autre part aussi par un Greek Armenian Committee qui a été créé par le haut commissaire britannique dans lequel siégeaient des Grecs et des Arméniens et qui gérait au quotidien tous ces problèmes.
The archives of the Patriarchate, Armenian Patriarchate of Istanbul, as well as documents produced by a Greco-Armenian Committee set up by the High Commissioners, document the processes after the armistice quite well.
Bon, concurremment, on a le début des procès des criminels de guerre jeunes turcs et parallèlement donc des démarches pour essayer de faire recouvrir leurs droits aux rescapés qui rentrent dans leur foyer. Et la clé, évidemment, la clé de cette affaire, c'était de supprimer cette loi de septembre 1915. Et sans la suppression de cette loi, il était impossible de rétablir ces gens dans leurs droits.
Concomitantly, we have an attempt, which is the essential of what the essential part of what Raymond Kevorkian stated, to abrogate the law of September 1915, which basically legalized the spoliation that we have discussed up to now.
Alors, le gouvernement libéral avait un problème central à surmonter pour supprimer cette loi. C'était d'abord de se débarrasser de tous les fonctionnaires jeunes turcs qui occupaient 80% des fonctionnaires et des militaires étaient en fait des jeunes turcs. Et
the then Ottoman government was called the liberal government. It was led by a particular Ottoman party which had nothing to do with the Committee of Union and Progress that governed the empire during the First World War. And that liberal government after the war was faced with a problem. That is, 80% of the officials of the empire and of the military were affiliated with the Committee of Union and Progress. So in order to carry out anything, to enact any kind of change, They had to get rid of those officials who controlled everything in the empire.
L'autre problème était qu'ils s'affrontaient en fait à tous les notables de province qui étaient les principaux bénéficiaires de ces spoliations.
In addition, they were coming into conflict with all the provincial notables, most of whom had been the main beneficiaries of the process of spoliation during the First World War. That is, they had taken over the Armenian properties, fields, primitive factories, and everything.
Donc il y a eu plusieurs plaintes évidemment déposées par le patriarcat arménien, représentant légitime. Et c'est finalement le 21 janvier 1920 que la loi de restauration des propriétés arméniennes a été adoptée.
There were many complaints by the Armenian Patriarchate of Istanbul as things went very slowly, and it is only on the 21st of January 1920 that restitution of a law restituting the Armenian properties, which included 33 articles, was finally adopted in the Ottoman Parliament.
Bon, j'ai indiqué là dans mon papier les principaux articles. Ça, je pense que ça intéressera les juristes. Mais pour résumer les choses, l'immense problème qu'il y avait, c'est que la plupart des propriétés immobilières étaient en fait aux mains de on va dire, non pas de propriétaires, puisqu'il n'y avait aucun document officiel, mais de gens qui les occupaient, et en particulier des muhajirs, donc des migrants, beaucoup de migrants, par exemple, originaires des Balkans.
I have here all the articles of this law, but that will be of interest to lawyers or specialists of the law, more generally. The main point to be remembered is that most of those spoliated properties, holdings, the Armenian cultural heritage and so on, were in the hands of people who occupied them de facto, without even property titles, okay? And a substantial chunk or segment of those people was made up of Turkic refugees from the Balkans or elsewhere, who just had taken over those properties upon the forced departure of the Armenians.
Donc en fait, cette loi, elle ne restitue pas physiquement ces biens, mais elle propose un dédommagement, une compensation.
So in practical terms, this law didn't restitute the properties, but suggested the possibility of some reparations to the people who had lost those properties. It was very difficult to drive out the de facto occupants of those houses and fields and so on.
Alors, revenons légèrement au contexte historique. En janvier 1920, lorsque cette loi est adoptée, l'ensemble de l'Asie mineure, en fait, est quasiment sous le contrôle soit des Grecs à l'ouest, qui ont envahi la région, soit des forces jeunes turco-kémalistes. Et la loi ne peut évidemment aucunement y être appliquée.
Let's return to the historical context at the beginning of the 1920, when the law was passed in January 1920. Most of what is now Turkey was in the hands, in the western part, of Greek forces. And in the rest of what is now current Turkey, of Kemalist forces. In a nutshell, the law was ineffectual in both parts of Turkey.
Malgré donc les limites de cette loi, hein, très restrictive, il faut indiquer que le 20 avril 1922, le gouvernement kémaliste, ou le contre-gouvernement, hein, on n'est pas encore dans une situation bien fixée, a adopté une motion condamnant la suppression de la loi de 1915.
Despite the limitations in the application of this law, in 1922, on the 20th of April 1922, ironically enough, the counter-government of Mustafa Kemal condemned the non-application, I believe, of the law of 1915.
C'est la loi qu'il condamne, la loi de suppression. Non, non, c'est plus haut.
Yeah, he condemns the law, you know, returning the properties.
Malgré son côté restrictif. Alors, il y a un point clé maintenant. Une fois établi au pouvoir, les Kémalistes, la grande assemblée de Turquie officiellement, le 15 avril 1923, donc un petit peu avant Lausanne, a adopté une nouvelle loi sur les biens abandonnés. Et, j'insiste, s'appuyant sur la loi du 26 septembre 1915, dont elle a juste changé quelques articles.
Once in power, the Kemalists, that is the Grand National Assembly, as they were called, adopted a new law on the 15th of April 1923, essentially reiterating the clauses of the law of the 26th of September 1915 about abandoned properties with some minor modifications. So they are reiterating what was accomplished with the law of September 1915.
Alors, par exemple, dans les changements notables de cette loi, les biens Wakof qui nous intéressent ici en particulier, qui à l'origine étaient enregistrés au ministère des Fondations Pieuses et au ministère des Finances, est transféré au Trésor.
Among the minor modifications, the Wakof holdings, which originally were registered in the Ministry of Pious Foundations or the Ministry of Finances. The registration of those holdings was now transferred to the Ministry of the Treasury.
Le traité de Lausanne a constitué par contre pour les autorités kémalistes un problème. Cette loi venait en contradiction avec le traité qu'ils ont signé. Donc,
The Treaty of Lausanne proved to be a problem for the Kemalists since the law they had just passed contradicted the new treaty they had signed with European powers.
L'élément central, en fait, c'est que l'État turc, de par le traité de Lausanne, a l'obligation de restituer les propriétés à leurs propriétaires légitimes.
The central problem was that according to the treaty of Lausanne, the Turkish state had to restitute the properties, so-called abandoned properties,
sans condition.
Legal owners without any conditions.
Donc, cet arsenal a été effectivement adopté, mais dans les faits, les autorités kémalistes n'ont jamais appliqué ces modifications de la loi se conformant au traité de Lausanne.
In practice, and de facto, the Kemalist authorities never applied the clauses of the Treaty of Lausanne, which they had signed.
À partir de 1925, il y a eu toute une série de décrets qui ont été lancés par les autorités visant à légitimer la propriété ou en tout cas l'occupation de ces biens arméniens par des personnes physiques ou morales.
After 1925, and we don't need to go into the details, various decrees were promulgated aimed at legitimizing the transfer of properties to their new occupants and owners as a result of the Armenian genocide.
Je vais vous lire juste un petit passage de la loi du 13 juin 26, c'est encore une autre. Elle rappelle que l'État a l'obligation de saisir les propriétés abandonnées, notamment si les autorités ont constaté l'abandon de ces biens avant la signature du traité de Lausanne.
I am going to read an excerpt of a new law adopted on the 13th of June 1926, which modified the earlier laws of the 26th of September 1915 and of the 20th, and it states that the state has a responsibility, okay, to take over the properties that had been abandoned, especially if they had been abandoned before the signing of the Treaty of Lausanne, which was indeed the case since the genocide started in 1915. So there is a whole process, these are my comments now, of legalizing ex post facto what was outright theft and looting resulting from massacres and genocide.
Je vais vous donner deux chiffres qui vont un petit peu illustrer le poids de cette captation de biens arméniens. Environ 500 millions de livres or turcs sont gérés, de biens arméniens, sont gérés par la fondation charitable, Vakıflar.
I will try to give you a sense of the extent of what took place. For example, in the 1920s, about 500 million gold sterling worth of Armenian holdings were managed by the Turkish state.
Oui, par les fondations charitables.
By the,
ouais.
The pious foundations, which of course were under the control of the Turkish state.
La même année, en 1923, le budget général de l'État turc est de 113 millions de livres or turc.
In the same year, 1923,
hein? Oui, oui.
Okay. The overall budget of the Ottoman Empire was 111 million gold sterling. So the properties they were managing were 4.5 or 4.6 times larger than the annual budget of the Ottoman Empire at that time.
Dernièrement, un historien turc, Nevzat Onaran, a publié un ouvrage qui inventorie toutes les lois qui ont été adoptées après 1925. Alors, je ne vais pas vous en faire le catalogue là, il l'a très bien fait. La dernière en date a été adoptée au lendemain du coup d'État de 1980.
Lately, a Turkish historian, Nevzat Onaran, has published a book in which he basically lists all the laws that have been adopted since the deportations and the genocide, the last one being a law adopted after the military coup d'etat of the 1980s. If I may add a comment, since I know what you wrote, this shows the continuity and even 65 years later attempts at cleaning up the mess and legalizing what has been done. No?
En fait, ces lois ont vocation à légaliser la situation des usufruitiers de ces biens arméniens. Il n'y a aucun document. Ces gens habitent là sans être propriétaires. Donc il a fallu, par couches successives, digérer en quelque sorte la captation légale de ces biens.
So these laws, the goal of these laws was essentially, as mentioned, to legalize the status of the people who occupied those properties, because those people had no property title to their holdings and properties. So the process went on up to the 1980s at least.
Le dernier commentaire que je vais faire, ça concerne les biens Wakuf. Vous avez vu que pendant l'été, l'été 2011, une loi a été adoptée par le gouvernement AKP visant à restituer les biens Wakuf aux institutions des minoritaires grecs, arméniens, etc.
My last comment will be about a law of the AKP government, the current Islamist government of Turkey, aimed at, theoretically, I add this adverb, restituting the properties confiscated, the Wakuf properties confiscated before 1936. This took place in the summer of 2011, just a month ago, actually, that the government proclaim it was going to do so.
Et là, il y a également une continuité très nette. On est dans la même logique. Tous ces biens sont déjà occupés ou vendus. Donc, il n'est question en fait que d'indemnisation ou de dédommagement.
All those properties they are talking about have already been sold or they are occupied. So the issue here is that it's probably a reference to possible indemnizations to their original owners if they can prove they were their original owners.
Est-ce que j'ai quelques
minutes? This is perfect. Yeah, encore 3-4 minutes.
D'accord. Je voudrais vous dire maintenant deux mots d'un aspect, un prolongement en quelque sorte, concernant le patrimoine monumental arménien, ces milliers d'églises et de monastères. Les biens Wakuf que j'ai mentionnés, plus de 2500 églises et 400 monastères, ne concernent pas en fait bien d'autres édifices qui étaient à l'état de ruines déjà au début du XXe siècle, mais qui constituent aussi un élément concret de ce patrimoine. On oublie, on va dire, l'angle du génocide et voyons cela sous l'angle de la protection des biens culturels.
Yes, all the monuments I have mentioned, the Armenian cultural heritage, more than 2,500 churches, more than 400 monasteries and so on. Besides those, there were many other monuments and properties that were in very bad shape or those are not included in this listing. Beyond the spoliation, the issue here is an issue of protection of cultural heritage.
À ce titre, il entre en fait, enfin ces biens entrent dans la réglementation qui a été adoptée au cours de ces dernières décennies par le Conseil de l'Europe à Strasbourg.
As they pertain to the cultural heritage of Armenians or the patrimony of the Armenians, these properties fall within the purview of the laws adopted by the European Union pertaining to cultural heritage over the past couple of decades.
Donc, mettons de côté la dimension, je dirais, de propriétaire officiel. La question qui se pose, c'est la protection de ces biens et en soulignant que la Turquie est membre du Conseil de l'Europe et à ce titre a le devoir de se conformer à cette loi, à ces lois.
Turkey being a member of the European Council, it is supposed to conform to the laws preserving the cultural heritage of various groups.
Alors, au cours de ces dernières années, des équipes européennes et une équipe d'Arménie ont mis en place, dans le cadre d'un programme européen financé par l'Union européenne, un projet de, pas un projet, une base de données, donc regroupant la documentation photographique sur le patrimoine monumental arménien.
Over the past few years, various teams, European teams, as well as a team from Armenia, have worked together to constitute a database of all the Armenian properties in the former Ottoman Empire.
Cette base de données, qui va être inaugurée le mois prochain à Yerevan, comporte à peu près 250 000 documents.
This database, which will be inaugurated next month in Yerevan, includes 250,000 documents.
Alors, elle est bien entendu, elle n'est pas complète, mais elle constitue un outil de travail particulièrement intéressant.
This is not a complete database. Nonetheless, it is a tool, a very useful tool. To deal with this issue of Armenian patrimony and heritage.
Comme nous avons dedans 7 à 8 collections différentes, que ces collections s'étendent sur les années 1956-2005.
As we have in that database 7 to 8 different collections stretching from the 1950s 2005.
On arrive en fait à faire du comparatisme et à voir l'évolution, je peux mettre des guillemets à évolution, de l'état de ces monuments.
We can indulge in comparative studies and appreciate, quote unquote, the evolution of those monuments, that is their destruction or dilapidation over the years. That's what is being meant.
Nous n'avons pas fini en fait le travail comparatiste qui va demander des années, mais à la date d'aujourd'hui, on est à peu près à 450 édifices, parfois petits, mais parfois carrément un complexe monastique, qui ont disparu au cours de ces 50 dernières années.
We haven't finished the comparative work at this point, but we have already found out that there are at least 450 monuments. It can be monasteries, it can be churches, anything that have disappeared over the past few years.
Alors ce programme s'appelle Armeniaca.
This program's name is Armeniaca. Voilà. Well, Raymond, thank you so much for, again, a very specific, detailed and well-documented paper that sheds light on just one dimension of Armenian properties, but does it very convincingly. And we are going to wait for the final session to have questions pertaining to this issue of genocide, looting, and their consequences pertaining to properties. At this point, we are going to watch a video because I had invited Professor Katrin Kesejian from the same university as Professor Sur, Paris 2, and unfortunately she had health problems, but she was kind enough to send us a video, a kind of 18-minute video about how she views her view about how best to approach the issue of the Armenian genocide. And you can see penguins behind me. But in the meanwhile, I would like to introduce her, even in absentia. Just a second, please. Professor Katrin Kesejian is also a professor agrégé. I defined that this morning, of law. She teaches at the same university as Professor Su. Of private international law, yes, it's not public. And at the University of Panthéon Assas, also known as Paris 2, which is the most prominent legal school in France. She is the director of a master program in European law. She is the deputy director of the European College of Paris and the professor of European business law, private international law, international dispute resolution, and international commercial arbitration at the University of Panthéon Assas, Paris 2. In 2004, she was appointed a Hauser Global Professor at New York University School of Law, where she teaches international commercial transactions and a seminar on rule-making processes in a global world. She is currently acting as a mediator or arbitrator in a number of international, transnational disputes under the auspices of international organizations. Before joining the University of Paris 2, she was Deputy Secretary General of the Hague Conference on Private International Law from 1996 to 2000. And prior to joining that conference, she was the director of the European Law Center at the Université de Bourgogne. She was also a practicing attorney in Paris from 1982 to 1998, focusing on transnational litigation and international business transaction. She received her legal education from the University of Paris, her doctorate, and the University of Pennsylvania Law School, her LLM. And I am pleased to now click the video.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it is with regret that I am missing the conference organized by the Armenian Studies Program at UC Berkeley. but I'm happy to have found this alternative mean to address you nonetheless. The title of my presentation is The Antonym of Oblivion and Denial is Not Memory, but Justice. This title borrows from an idea expressed by Joseph Yerushalmi, the American historian, in a book published in France in 1988 called Usage politique de l'oubli. It is also an idea permeating Paul Ricoeur's work published in 2000, La mémoire, l'histoire, l'oubli. The same idea is behind a new trend in legal studies and practice called transitional justice, which has triggered considerable interest in the past 20 years. To cite only a few, you may recall Mr. Barkin, The Guilt of Nations, Restitutions and Negotiation, Historical Injustices, or Maris' Apologies for the Past and the Quest for Historical Justice, or I can cite also Torpe, Making Whole What Has Been Smashed, on Reparation Politics. The fact that the Armenians have had no court before which to present their grievances has been one of the main reasons why, almost 100 years after the facts, we are still unable to be forward-looking. This is true not only for the Armenians, but also for the people of Turkey. As the French bishop said in 1997, it's a declaration apropos Shoah, no group, no society, no individual can live at peace with itself, herself, or himself with a repressed past or a lie about it. This conference is convened to appraise some of the past and in particular the Wilson arbitration and the Kars Treaty. I will leave to others the appraisal since I'm not a historian and I know you have with you several participants whose public international law knowledge is far superior to mine. May I just air two remarks. One, if the Wilson arbitration has any effect today, we must recognize its very limited scope since it deals only with territory and its effects are indeed highly debatable. Second, all treaties are fine, but we all know that treatises are as good as the will of the parties. Treaties are denounced easily, and if not denounced, subsequent state practice may nullify their effect. On the front of justice, one must recognize that not many fora are open to the Armenians. In fact, it is a euphemism. Litigation against insurance companies, banks, and other private actors are necessary, and I'm comforted by the fact that lawyers have had some success in this area. However, these do not put at peace the Armenians as a collective body. In addition, these trials are limited to the United States, where international jurisdictional rules are expensive but not matched in other countries. We must also understand that the crime which the Armenians have suffered is a state crime. Whatever characterization you give to the crime, whether it is a genocide or crime against humanity. On this question of characterization, we should remember that the historical start of the expression crime against humanity was used at the Paris Conference dealing with the aftermath of the First World War and the crimes against the Armenians. We also know that Raphael Lemkin, the very well-known inspirator of the Genocide Convention, knew about the Armenian history and particularly had followed the trial of Sogomon Telerian for the assassination of Talat Pasha in 1921. Whether or not the present state of Turkey is the successor to the Ottoman Empire does not really matter. We have to deal with a state whose policy presently is based on denial. It is with that state that we must work. There are many ways we can deal with that state. I'm going to cover only three ways today in a very brief remark. The first one is to create a common narrative. Many institutions and NGOs are working towards such a goal. For example, the Institute for Historical Justice and Reconciliation, which is based in The Hague, have launched what they call the Journey Towards Understanding project, which is intended to increase confidence building between Armenian and Turkish historians, cultural experts, civil society leaders, and others interested in improving cultural relations and historical understanding between Armenia and Turkey. The front page of the website of the Institute speaks of a project aims at fostering Armenian-Turkish dialogue about culture and history, and in doing so, deconstruct historical myths that continue to challenge reconciliation efforts. I'm not entirely sure that I understand what they know and what they understand by historical myth, but this is what you can read on that front page. To achieve this aim, the project is divided into two components. The first component is a documentary on the Armenian-Turkish cultural heritage of the archaeologic site of Ani and the city of Kars. This documentary is intended to bring attention to the shared cultural heritage of Armenians and Turks who have lived for centuries in this region during the early medieval period. Again, whether we have to stick to only the medieval period is unclear to me. The second component is a shared Armenian-Turkish narrative on the cultural, social, and economic life in the neighboring cities of Kars in eastern Turkey and Gumriye in Armenia. Again, these common narratives, it's not the only aim of the Institute that I've mentioned, and many other NGOs are doing it, but I think it's necessary, but it's not the only way we must use. The second way is what we call in France les lois mémorielles. This is very controversial. I'm not going to talk about all the lois mémorielles. We could translate that in English as memory statutes. The only one that I'm going to mention briefly is the January 29, 2001 statute on the genocide of the Armenians. It started on May 29, 1998, when the National Assembly adopted a single article private bill, which reads, "The Republic recognizes publicly the Armenian Genocide of 1915. After further discussion in Parliament, this text became the statute of January 29, 2001. Four elements are remarkable in this statute. The first one is that the crime is characterized using a category of international and domestic criminal law. Second, the victims, the Armenians, are named. Third, there is a total silence on two points, the country where this crime took place and the authors of the crime, due to obvious diplomatic considerations. Last, this historical event had no connection whatsoever with French history at the time, whether one looks at the place, the authors of the crime, or its victims. But it shows the evolution of transitional justice, whereby the present place of the victims, the present situation of the victims, is a substantial link for either legislative or jurisdictional activity. We are only at the beginning of that trend, and we have to continue towards the same goal. This was the first act. The second act before the French Parliament, opened in late 2005 and in 2006, when several private bills were introduced in the National Assembly, making it an offense to deny the genocide of the Armenians. Their authors failed in May 2006, but succeeded in October 2006. The final bill was sent to the Senate and has remained there since then without any further activity. Now, as you may have heard, yesterday night, the French Senate changed majority, and perhaps it is the time to revive this bill. Historians have been very divided. Historians in France and probably elsewhere have been very divided about these statutes. Some are opposed to the mix of law and memory. On December 13, 2005, a group of 19 historians signed a declaration, a manifesto, in Libération, the newspaper, called Freedom for History, where they argued that history is not a religion, accepts no dogmas, is not morality, the historian's role is not to exalt or to condemn, but to explain, and history is not a memory, and of course it must take it into consideration, but has nothing to do with the kind of public acknowledgement that a bill, a statute, or a court decision can do. And what they said further is neither parliament nor courts should define historical truth. They finally asked for the abrogation of the statutes. Other historians, in the years after this manifesto, answered with exactly opposite ideas. They said that to condemn publicly genocides and other crimes against humanity is necessary, that it is the role of a parliament to take a position about events of the past, particularly in order for the society to get around values and legitimate goals. I'm not going to say my own opinion on the loi mémorielle. I think there are pros and cons in the issue. But what I want to say in the last part of my remarks today is the third way in which I think we should devote more time and efforts from now on. The third way is to create a judicial forum of a sui generis nature and structure, so that the Armenians would have their day in court and Turkey could defend its position in an open forum. This forum could be entrusted with the matter of reparation. Now, I know reparation is also a very controversial issue. We know that for a long time, some in the Armenian communities said that they were not interested in reparation in the hope that the Turkish government would recognize the 1915 events and somehow apologize. This is not coming, and in my dark days I must say that I think it may never come. This is why we have, I think, to take another language, and now it's time to demand reparation. I may recall what Maris writes about what he calls complete apologies. I would not basically use the same words, but that those are his words. And he says there are four features to that. One, an acknowledgement of a wrong committed, including the harm that it caused. Two, an acceptance of responsibility for having committed the wrong. Three, an expression of regret or remorse, both for the harm and for having committed the wrong. Four, a commitment, explicit or implicit, to reparation and, when appropriate, to non-repetition of the wrong. This is all well, but until civil society in Turkey will really have a say, an influence on its government, instead of the dark sides of the society, this will not come unilaterally from Turkey. This is why we have to work towards the creation of an alternative forum where some kind of decision can be taken. Yet, you must not be mistaken. Reparation can take a lot of varying forms. Of course, it can be monetary compensation, it can be territory demands, it can be property restitutions, but it can be symbolic reparations, and those are very important. We have examples in the past that the construction of one or more memorials or a museum could be a kind of reparation which would satisfy at least part of the Armenian communities. For example, we can also be inspired by the French statute of 10 July 2000, which created a national memorial day for the victims of racism and anti-Semitic crimes of the French state. I repeat this is important. The statute creates a memorial day for the victims of racism and anti-Semitic crimes of the French state and of public tribute to the righteous. Now, I'm aware we are a long way away from that particular goal, but I think it is worth a try. I would like to end with these words borrowed from Victor Hugo. De la même façon que se fait le jour, se fait la paix. Le jour par le lever de l'astre, la paix par l'ascension du droit. Thank you for your attention.
We have now reached the last speaker for this event, who will be dealing with the Armenian genocide from the perspective of international law. The title of his lecture is Ex Iniuria Non Oritur Ius, Genocide and the Non-Applicability of Statutes of Limitation to Claims Arising from Genocide. That speaker is Professor Alfred Desayas. And Professor Desayas is a retired United Nations lawyer, a former chief of petitions with the Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights and Secretary of the Human Rights Committee of the UN. He is an expert on war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide, and has published pertinent scholarly books and articles, including the 2009 handbook United Nations Human Rights Committee Case Law 1977-2008, published by Kell, a 2010 legal opinion on the genocide against the Armenians and the relevance of the Genocide Convention, published by the Haigazian University Press. We distributed flyers to you regarding that book, and there might be some left there. A study on ethnic cleansing and the remedies available to victims, Heimatrecht is East mentioned Recht. Homeland law, I think, right to the homeland is human right, something like that, eh? Yeah, Munich. He is also a noted historian with a double doctorate. I think international law from Harvard was not enough, so he got a doctorate in history from the University of Göttingen. It's not a bad place. And he has book publications on Nuremberg, minorities, refugees, forced population transfers, including his latest Völkermord als Staatsgeheimnis, which means genocide as state secret. And many other publications such as Nemesis at Potsdam, A Terrible Revenge, and so on. At present, Professor Desayas teaches public international law at the Geneva School of Diplomacy, and he offers, among others, a master's seminar on history, genocide, and law, which gives contour to these some of his publications. I had heard of Professor Desayas years ago, and it has been a real pleasure to meet him in person and to have conversations with him over the past 2 days. So he is welcome.
Thank you very much, Professor Asturian. Associate Secretary General Sarayadarayan, Professor Karvokian, Professor Sur, ladies and gentlemen, before I launch into my lecture, I want to make a comment on what we just saw on the loi mémorielle, on the memory laws. She mentioned the appel de Blois of Professor Pierre Nora of the Académie Française, 10th October 2008. And what that intends to say is, look, lawyers, historians have a right to be wrong. Historians have a right to do their work without lawyers making it a criminal offense to make a mistake. And last 21st July 2011, the Human Rights Committee adopted a General Comment 34, on Article 19. That's the article on freedom of opinion and freedom of expression. And paragraph 49 of that General Comment, it's a 16-page General Comment, is very clear in condemning memory loss. The Human Rights Committee, and I must say in the United States, memory loss would be totally impossible because the U.S. Constitution, the Bill of Rights, I mean, the First Amendment is freedom of expression, and that is really a cornerstone of this country. And I have sympathy for that. As much as I condemn the Armenian genocide, as much as I condemn negationism, I don't want to make martyrs. And I don't want to put, say, my friend, Professor Norman Stone in Istanbul, he used to be in Oxford. Norman Stone is a negationist. He's wrong. But I don't want to put him in jail for that. I think you have a right to be wrong. And you have a right to be a fool if you want to be a fool. And that must be quite distinctly separated from incitement to racial hatred. It's a function of the lawyer to define all the elements of the crime, to establish criteria to determine if incitement is intended. But for a historian to come and say, well, I'm just simply not convinced, that cannot be a criminal offense. And 99% of the Turks today have been indoctrinated into believing there was never a genocide. And it's an item of faith for them. It's almost not even an issue of freedom of opinion. It's almost a religious opinion because they have such a conviction that it never happened because they've been educated, it's been drummed into them that it was never a genocide, that they will come and say, no, there was no genocide. Now, I'm not gonna put someone who says that in jail. It takes a long time, but I will take the time to convince them that it was a genocide. But in any event, that is by way of introduction and comment to what we just saw. Now, the historicity of the systematic discrimination, persecution, deportation, and murder of 1.5 million Armenians 1915-1923 is well established and generally recognized more and more as constituting the first genocide of the 20th century. These persecutions and massacres had a prehistory of abuse characterized by the massacres of some 200,000 Armenians in 1894-96, and by the subsequent Adana massacres of 1909 that claimed a further 30,000 innocent lives. As we know, history is not mathematics, and knowledge of the facts does not immediately result in reparation of the damage. Law is necessary for that, not only treaties and conventions, but also natural law, general principles of law, the pronouncements of the highest national and international courts and tribunals. Again, the legal norms are not identical with their enforcement. For that, the political will of the powerful nations is necessary, which often enough is driven by other considerations of a geopolitical and economic nature, vital interests that frequently hinder the proper application of the law. Thus, an appeal to the clear language of the Treaty of Sèvres or to the provisions of the arbitral award of President Woodrow Wilson does not automatically lead to the implementation of that important general principle, ubi jus ibi remedium, where there is a law, there must also be a remedy. Here again, it is necessary to create the conditions that will allow reparation to the victims, including the adoption in national law of what is termed enabling legislation and the establishment of a competent judicial instance to which claims can be submitted for examination and settlement. There are multiple obstacles that must be overcome on the way to recognition and reparation. Some of these obstacles have already been overcome. The first obstacle was silence. Everybody knows what Hitler sarcastically said about the world's indifference and oblivion about the Armenians. Yet, by now in 2011, the gruesome reality of the Armenian genocide has been recognized by an ever-increasing number of governments and parliaments, and even by the judiciary. Not long ago, on 1st April 2011, the Argentinian Poder Judicial de la Nación, the Federal Court of Buenos Aires, issued a declarative resolution. I have it here, and I also have the English translation. Resolución declarativa de los sucesos históricos conocidos como el genocidio del pueblo armenio años 1915-1924. This declarative resolution on the basis of extensive evidence submitted to the court. This ruling followed a 10-year truth trial, establishing that the relatives of Mr. Gregorio Hayrabedian died in the Armenian genocide and that therefore he was entitled to know the truth of what had happened to his relatives. Pursuant to this ruling, the Argentinian government formally wrote to the Turkish government asking for their investigation and response. Predictably, the Turkish government dismissed the inquiry. The Argentinian legal finding, however, can pave the way not only for requests to obtain information, but also will pave the way to claims for reparation that may be submitted in the Argentinian judicial system. Other obstacles to recognition and reparation are more subtle. The obstacle of disinformation by the well-organized Turkish negationist machinery still confuses many. Disinformation engenders doubt, which simply paralyzes even well-meaning persons who feel unable to decide who is right and who is wrong, and then, using a false logic, determine that the truth must lie somewhere midpoint between the Turkish and the Armenian positions. Another obstacle is that of what I would call the Turkish red herrings. And there are oceans of them, intended to divert attention from the real issue and blithely ignoring what cannot be denied, the evident destruction of 4,000 years of Armenian presence in Asia Minor, in what was known as Western Armenia, the destruction of the 2,500 churches and 450 monasteries, of the villages, of cemeteries, of monuments and symbols. Through these red herrings, the Turkish authorities deflect our vision toward the lame excuse that In all armed conflicts, civilians get caught in the crossfire that the Ottoman authorities only wanted to, quote, evacuate, unquote, Armenians from the war zone, that many perish not intentionally, but because of epidemics and bad weather. This is exactly the same kind of negationist rubbish used by the apologists of the Nazis, who want to deny, diminish, or trivialize the Holocaust. Himmler, too, he spoke euphemistically only of an evacuation, not of the murder of Jews. There are other, more sophisticated red herrings used by the Turkish government and by their fellow travelers to mislead public opinion. Even those who are willing to accept that grave injustices were committed against the Armenians try to escape with a false argument that there is, unfortunately, no applicable law that would grant reparation to the Armenians, contending, for instance, that the Genocide Convention of 9 December 1948 is subsequent to the Armenian tragedy and that it cannot be applied retroactively. I think that in my book, The Genocide Against the Armenians, 1915-1923, and the relevance of the Genocide Convention, I have definitively refuted this particular red herring. Now, this exists in English and in Spanish. It's been translated in Spanish and produced in Buenos Aires. And my hope is that there will be a French edition and there will be a German edition. And I'm pleased to say that a friend of mine, Eva Salkiewicz, has been translated into Polish. So it's supposed to be published by University of Warsaw at some point this year. Yet another red herring is the argument that Turkey is not the successor state of the Ottoman Empire and that it therefore does not have a duty of reparation. This argumentation was tried unsuccessfully by Serbia in connection with the crimes committed by the Federal Republic of Yugoslavia. It is to the credit of the Federal Republic of Germany that its government did not attempt to escape responsibility for the Holocaust by having recourse to a supposed tabula rasa and virgin birth of the country without any links to the past. There is yet another reason why this argument necessarily fails, and that is that the genocidal acts of the Ottoman Empire were continued under Kemal Atatürk, as we have heard. And not only against the Armenians, but also against the Greeks of Pontus, the Greeks of Smyrna, the Chaldeo-Assyrians, and other Christian minorities in the Turkish Republic. Not only were massacres committed against the Christian minorities, but there was a concerted effort to erase their memory, to efface all traces of their existence in Asia Minor for thousands of years. A deliberate policy of cultural genocide characterized by the destruction of churches, cemeteries, and symbols, priceless cultural heritage that today should be reconstructed and recognized not only as Armenian heritage, but as UNESCO World Heritage of Mankind. It is this kind of continuous violation of international law and of human rights norms that is so often ignored by the media. In a very real sense, the Turkish authorities are practicing the old Roman policy of damnatio memoriae, the destruction of memory, of the memory of victims, as if they had never existed. The same fate that Hitler had intended for the murdered Jews, the same fate that Stalin imposed on his adversaries, the same fate that George Orwell described so well in his novel 1984. Notwithstanding the bad faith of most of the Turkish arguments, some non-Turkish entities have fallen for the red herrings, including the Center for Transitional Justice, and even some academics have supported the efforts to close the page on the Armenian genocide and leave the descendants of the survivors of the genocide without recognition and without reparation, without truth, without history. This is yet another reason to be circumspect and not let oneself be drawn into the trap of the Turkish-Armenian protocols of 10 October 2009, which are fundamentally flawed and would ultimately betray the memory of the victims. Ladies and gentlemen, murder. Murder has been a sin since Cain killed Abel, long before the first attempts by lawyers to codify penal law, before the Hammurabi and other ancient codes. More fundamentally, murder is a crime by virtue of natural law, which is prior to and superior to positivistic law. Crimes against humanity were crimes before the British, French, and Russian note condemned the Armenian massacres in 1915, calling them, quote, a crime against humanity and civilization for which all members of the Turkish government will be held responsible together with its agents implicated in the massacres, unquote. The word did not exist yet, but genocide was a crime long before Raphael Lemkin coined the term in 1944. According to Article 38 of the Statute of the International Court of Justice, general principles of law are a principal source of law. Not only positivistic law, not only treaties, protocols, and charters, but also the immanent principles of law are sources of law before the International Court of Justice and can be invoked. Among such principles are the principle ex injuria non oritur jus, which lays down the rule that out of a violation of law, no new law can emerge and no rights can be derived. This is a basic principle of justice and of common sense. Another general principle of law, I already mentioned, is ubi jus ibi remedium. Where there's law, there's also a remedy. In other words, where there has been a violation of law, there must be restitution to the victims. This principle was reaffirmed by the Permanent Court of International Justice in its famous judgment in the Chorso factory case in 1928. Another general principle of law is that the thief cannot keep the fruits of the crime. Another principle stipulates that the law must be applied in good faith, uniformly, not selectively. Thus, there is no international law a la carte. And yet, there are those who claim that the Armenians have no justiciable rights because the Genocide Convention was adopted in 1948, more than 30 years after the Armenian Genocide, and because treaties are not normally applied retroactively. This, of course, is a fallacy because the Genocide Convention was drafted and adopted precisely in the light of the Armenian Genocide and in the light of the Holocaust. Not only the Armenian Genocide, but also the Holocaust itself predated the convention. And no one would question the legitimacy of the claims of the survivors and descendants of the victims of the Holocaust simply because the Nazi atrocities were committed before the entry into force of the Genocide Convention. It bears repeating that the rights of the Armenians do not, I repeat, do not derive from the Genocide Convention. Rather, the Genocide Convention strengthens the pre-existing rights of the Armenians to recognition as victims, to restitution, and to compensation. Articles 144 and 230 of the Treaty of Sèvres, signed on 10 August 1920 by four representatives of the Ottoman Sultan Mehmed VI, recognized the rights of the survivors of the extermination campaign against the Christian minorities of the empire, including the Armenians, the Greeks from Pontus, the Chaldeo-Assyrians, and affirmed the obligation of the Turkish state to investigate these crimes and punish the guilty. I was going to read the text, but I guess I'd better skip it because I still have quite a few pages to go through. So I'm skipping the text on Article 133, on the issue of reparation and compensation. Article 230, a very important article, stipulated the obligation to punish. So this is the principle of no impunity. So that was already in 1920 laid down and signed and recognized by the Turkish authorities. Even though the League of Nations never established an international criminal tribunal to try the Turkish perpetrators of the genocide against the Armenians, numerous trials under Turkish law, on the Turkish penal law, did take place in Istanbul in 1919, even before the Treaty of Sèvres was signed. The Turkish authorities conducted these trials against Ottoman officials involved in the genocide pursuant to the Ottoman penal code. Many were convicted and three were executed. I mean, it's important to remind the world that there were trials, and not only the trials in absentia of Talat Pasha and of Enver Pasha, but also of high officials, and three of them, as I said, were executed. The Treaty of Sèvres, however, as everybody knows, was not implemented because of a coup d'etat against the Sultan conducted by a famous Turkish general, Mustafa Kemal, who not only overthrew the Sultan, but proceeded to wage war against the Greeks and French and British, push him out of Anatolia, and negotiate a new peace treaty with the Allies, which ensured impunity for the thousands of Turkish officials, officers, and soldiers involved in the massacres. To deny that the Armenian massacres amounted to genocide manifests both ignorance and bad faith. There is no doubt that the Armenian genocide was many, many times worse than the ethnic cleansing that occurred in the former Yugoslavia in the 1990s, a crime which the United Nations General Assembly, in its resolution 47/121 of 1992, considered, quote, a form of genocide, unquote. There's no doubt that the massacres of the Armenians were many times worse than the massacre of Srebrenica, which the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia and the International Court of Justice have condemned as genocide. But let us return to the general principle of law ubi ius ibi remedium. What is of relevance today is not the punishment of the guilty, because no person criminally responsible for the massacres is still alive. What is crucial is the right to the Armenian homeland, which entails the right to return and the right to restitution and compensation. In this context, it is relevant to cite the final report of the United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Human Rights Dimensions of Population Transfers on Shawkat al-Hassani, today the Jordanian judge at the International Court of Justice. The declaration appended to the report, which was formally adopted by the Commission on Human Rights and subsequently by ECOSOC, provides in its Article 8, I quote, every person has the right to return voluntarily and in safety and dignity to the country of origin and within it to the place of origin or choice. The exercise of the right to return does not preclude the victim's right to adequate remedies, including restoration of properties of which they were deprived in connection with or as a result of population transfers, compensation for any property that cannot be restored to them, and any other reparations provided for in international law. The Armenians have undoubtedly a strong and legitimate claim to receive reparation from Turkey for the material and immense moral injury that accompanied the genocide perpetrated not only in the period 1915 and 1923, but also for the earlier massacres, which everybody forgets, the massacres of 1896 and 1909. Bearing in mind that there is no prescription in international law in cases of genocide and crimes against humanity, the Armenian entitlement for reparation has certainly not lapsed. Therefore, it is only normal that Armenians should continue to press their demand for reparation in the form of restitution of their cultural and religious heritage, including the churches and monasteries, compensation for the destroyed property, as well as for the moral suffering endured, and a measure of satisfaction in the form of an effort to find, an effort at finding mass graves and the remains of the murdered relatives, an official apology from the government of Turkey, and recognition of their status as victims of genocide. This right to the various levels of reparation can and should be invoked by the survivors of the descendants of the Armenian genocide, both in Armenia and the diaspora. The norms of international law, which I shall briefly outline, are fairly clear. Nevertheless, these norms are not always self-executing and may require legislative action in order to identify the specific legal basis and establish the proper forum where claims for restitution and reparation may be adjudicated. What is most needed is the political will of governments throughout the world to ensure that appropriate legislative and judicial measures are taken in order to implement the applicable norms of international law. For this political will to materialize, it is necessary to mobilize civil society in all countries, to educate through the universities, high schools, and the media, and to appeal to the overarching principle of human dignity from which all human rights derive. To discriminate among victims of genocide is unacceptable and entails in itself a separate and distinct violation of human dignity. Now, the principle of reparation for violations of international law is not a new normative development attributable to the work of the League of Nations or of the United Nations or of the International Law Commission. The obligation to make reparation for violations of international law is, as I said before, a general principle of law as referred to in Article 38, paragraph 1c of the Statute of the International Court of Justice. Already, the Permanent Court of International Justice stated in 1928 in the Chorzów Factory case, quote, "It is a principle of international law and even a general conception of the law that any breach of an engagement involves an obligation to make reparation," unquote. Similarly, Article 31 of the draft statutes on state responsibility, which essentially reflect pre-existing international law, stipulates that, quote, "The responsible state is under an obligation to make full reparation for the injury caused by the internationally wrongful act," unquote. Article 34 stipulates further that full reparation for the injury caused by the international wrongful act shall take the form of restitution, compensation, or satisfaction, either singly or in combination. More concretely, in the Armenian case, where enormous destruction was visited on the cultural heritage of thousands of years, the Hague Convention for the Protection of Cultural Property of 1954 and its two protocols give us guidance. Obviously, we here have, again, the problem of retroactive application of treaties, but I'm not saying that the Hague Convention applies retroactively. I'm just saying that it gives us guidance in order to be able to get our thinking and our paradigms together. Among other general principles of law that apply in the context of the obligation to make reparation are the principle of good faith, the prohibition of an unjust enrichment, and the rules on estoppel. Bearing in mind that genocide and crimes against humanity are the most grievous offenses against international law, it is obvious that the murderer cannot keep the fruits of the crime. International ordre public, or public order, imposes this conclusion. Some will object that the Chorzów Factory case, the Hague Convention on the Protection of Cultural Property, the Genocide Convention, and the International Law Commission's articles on state responsibility are all subsequent to the genocide, and that therefore they cannot be applied. This is wrong. The fact is that the Armenian claims did not arise with any of these instruments, but were already in existence in 1915 and were recognized internationally in the already cited Article 144 of the Treaty of Sèvres, which was, as I said, signed by the representatives of the Sultan. The non-enforcement of Article 144 does not mean that the entitlements did not exist, but rather that the illegal use of force by Mustafa Kemal Atatürk prevented the implementation of applicable norms of international law. The non-enforcement of norms, even for a prolonged period of time, does not detract from their validity. And Armenians should not be discouraged because of the reluctance of some journalists and politicians to endorse their legitimate claims. As far as compensation is concerned, Article 36 of the Articles on State Responsibility stipulate the obligation of a state to compensate for the damage caused insofar as such damage is not made good by restitution. As far as satisfaction is concerned, Article 37 stipulates a state responsible for an international wrongful act is under an obligation to give satisfaction for the injury caused by the act insofar as its obligation cannot be made good by restitution or compensation. Satisfaction may consist in an acknowledgement of the breach, an expression of regret, a formal apology, or another appropriate modality. In this connection, it is useful to recall that in 1993, President Bill Clinton issued an apology to the people of Hawaii for the crimes and abuses committed in connection with the overthrow of the legitimate government of the Hawaiian Kingdom 100 years earlier in 1893. Similarly, on 13 February 2008, the Prime Minister of Australia, Kevin Rudd, issued an apology to the Aborigines of Australia for the many injustices visited upon them. It should be noted that title to huge areas of Australia, take Uluru, take Kachatucha, take Kakadu, has been returned to the Aborigines, who are now administering these territories in cooperation with the Australian central authorities. Even President Barack Obama signed a little publicized apology to the American indigenous in December 2009. Thus, even historical inequities can be partly redressed, provided that there be a modicum of goodwill. Indeed, over the past decades, the various governments of Germany have issued countless apologies to the governments and peoples of Poland, Czechoslovakia, that is Czech Republic, Slovakia, Belgium, the Netherlands, France, Israel, etc., in connection with the Holocaust. Germany has also made meaningful reparation in the form of both restitution and compensation to the survivors of the victims of the Holocaust. In obtaining reparation, the Armenians should also appeal to international solidarity and to the erga omnes obligation not to recognize the effects of war crimes and crimes against humanity. Article 10 of the United Nations Draft Declaration on the Illegality of Population Transfers stipulates, quote, where acts or omissions prohibited in the present declaration are committed, the international community as a whole and individual states are under an obligation, A, not to recognize as legal the situation created by such acts, B, in ongoing situations to ensure the immediate cessation of the act and the reversal of the harmful consequences, C, not to render aid, assistance or support, financial or otherwise, to the state which has committed or is committing such act in the maintaining or strengthening of the situation created by such act. End of quote. Of particular relevance to the Armenians are the basic principles and guidelines on the right to a remedy and reparation for victims of gross violations of international human rights law and of serious violations of international humanitarian law. This was adopted by the General Assembly in its Resolution 60/147 of 16 December 2005. Section 7, paragraph 10 of these basic principles stipulates remedies include the victim's right to the following as provided for under international law: equal and effective access to justice, adequate, effective, and prompt reparation for harm suffered, access to relevant information concerning violations and reparation mechanisms. Section 9, paragraph 15. Adequate, effective, and prompt reparation is intended to promote justice by redressing gross violations of international human rights law or serious violations of international humanitarian law. Reparation should be proportional to the gravity of the violations and the harms suffered. Paragraph 16, states should endeavor to establish national programs for reparation and other assistance to victims. paragraph 17 stipulates, states shall, with respect to claims of victims, enforce domestic judgments for reparation against individuals or entities liable for the harm suffered and endeavor to enforce valid foreign legal judgments. It's quite important. Enforce valid foreign legal judgments for reparation in accordance with domestic law and international legal obligations. Paragraph 19, restitution should, wherever possible, restore the victim to the original situation. This is what is called as restitutio in integrum. Paragraph 20, compensation should be provided for any economically assessable damage as appropriate and proportional to the violation and the circumstances of each case. I'm going to jump several sections here. Section 11 of particular relevance, which stipulates the application and interpretation of these basic principles, must be consistent with international human rights law and be without any discrimination of any kind or on any ground without exception. That is, the Armenians cannot be discriminated to the extent that there is reparation for other groups, whether it be the Kosovars, or whether it be the Serbs, or whether it be the Croatians, or whether it be the Bosnians. If there is reparation for others, you cannot say, well, I'm going to apply it in this case, but I'm not going to apply it in the other. Another significant United Nations document, I'm only citing a few, there's a slew of documents that the Armenians can, whether it be hard law or soft law, but you can use them. Here we have the so-called Pinheiro principles. And principle two stipulates all refugees and displaced persons have the right to have restored to them any housing, land, and or property, of which they were arbitrarily or unlawfully deprived, or to be compensated for any housing, land, and or property that is factually impossible to restore as determined by an independent impartial tribunal. Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, I could continue citing these norms of hard law. I've skipped several others. And I just want to make it clear that international law is on the side of the Armenians. Another thing, of course, is implementation. And the Armenians know better than anyone else what an uphill battle it has been to obtain recognition of the historicity of the genocide. Here again, the United Nations can strengthen the Armenian claims through its increasing insistence on the right to truth. I have a whole series of footnotes of resolutions and reports on the right to truth, including historical truth. This may be a right de lege ferenda, but a right that our Armenians can already invoke in the form of pertinent United Nations resolutions. I do not underestimate the obstacles before the Armenians in obtaining reparation for the injuries suffered in connection with the genocide. One problem is, as I already mentioned, the non-self-executing international norms. This is why countries like Austria and Germany have actually adopted specific laws in order to provide easy access and easy restitution to the victims of the Holocaust. Also in the United States, there is the law on restitution for the World War II internment victims, some 120,000 Japanese Americans and ALUs. It is a responsibility of politicians to propose such legislation to Congress, e.g. to make Armenian claims against Turkey justiciable in the United States. The United States has adopted the Federal Alien Tort Claims Act, pursuant to which Jewish claimants have been able to obtain redress. And if the Jewish claimants have had redress, why not the Armenians? The law is the law. I should also like to mention the possibility of entrusting to the United Nations with a responsibility to administer a fund for victims of the Armenian genocide and their descendants. Already in the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, we have several funds, e.g. for indigenous populations, for victims of torture, etc. And this experience would provide a blueprint for an Armenian United Nations fund. Let me alert the Armenians now to an important opportunity to disseminate information about the Armenian case. As you know, I was secretary of the Human Rights Committee and dealt with the examination of state party reports and the drafting of concluding observations
with concrete recommendations to states' parties for correcting violations of human rights and for providing remedies to the victims. Turkey has recently ratified the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and has submitted its initial report to the committee. This report, which you can download from the website of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, will be examined next year in July. This is the report. The report, of course, presents the sunny side of Turkey, and there is no discussion of the Armenian genocide or of the grave problems associated with the denialist policies of the government, nor with the prosecution and imprisonment of authors and editors who write about the Armenian genocide. The new penal code of 2005 still contains provisions such as Article 301, which are incompatible with Article 19 of the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, both in doctrine and in practice. This month, in October 2011, the committee is in session in Geneva and will be drafting a series of questions to be sent to Turkey in preparation for the examination of the report next year. The Armenian claims should be somehow reflected in this questionnaire. It is now for Armenian civil society and for non-governmental organizations to come to Geneva and be present when the questions are being drafted, and in July 2012, when the report will be examined. The report can be downloaded, as I said, from our website. You can also write directly and send information to the secretary of the Human Rights Committee, Kate Fox, and I have, of course, her email. Now, Turkey has also ratified the optional protocol to the ICCPR. I'm concluding. Which means that individuals can submit complaints to the Human Rights Committee following the exhaustion of domestic remedies. Of course, the committee lacks jurisdiction to pronounce on the genocide itself because the events are ratione temporis, because of when it occurred, outside the scope of its competence. But there are sequels to the genocide that themselves constitute violations of the covenant, including the persecution of Christians and the denial of the use of churches for worship, Article 18 of the Covenant, murder and intimidation of Christians and Armenians, Article 6 and Article 9 of the Covenant, including the murder of Hrant Dink, whom I personally knew and invited to a UN panel in 2004, discrimination on the basis of ethnic and religious origin, Article 26, the denial of the right to return to one's homeland, Article 12, the denial of the right to speak and publish about the Armenian genocide, Article 19, the refusal of Turkey to open its archives to allow investigation of the disappearance of millions of Armenians, Articles 7 and 9, also the right to truth and to identity, Article 17. Turkey must also report to the Human Rights Council in Geneva in the context of the new Universal Periodic Review Procedure. This procedure frequently addresses the issues of disappearance of persons and of the right of relatives of disappeared persons to investigation of the disappearances, to the opening of mass graves, and the right to historical truth. Armenians should be present whenever Turkey is called to account before international instances, including before the Council of Europe and the European Court of Human Rights. Thus, ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude by encouraging all Armenians to make use of United Nations and other international and national mechanisms established to redress injustices. It is the civic duty of all victims to articulate their complaints. It is wrong to keep silence about human rights violations because this renders future violations of human rights less costly for the perpetrator and feeds into a culture of impunity. Since there is no statute of limitations applicable in cases of genocide and crimes against humanity, the Armenian claims to restitution and compensation continue to be valid to this day. Most importantly, however, the Armenians have a right to recognition as victims. They have a right to truth and a right to historical memory. Such recognition is a fundamental human right and a sine qua non for reconciliation. For decades, the Armenians were victims of silence. And indeed, the crime of silence is worse than that of negationism. Therefore, as Ovidius observed, everybody knows Ovid, gutta cavat lapidem, the drop will eventually pierce the stone. I thank you for your attention. And I have an additional copy of the report if somebody needs it. This is the Turkish report for the Human Rights Committee.
Thank you so much, Professor De Zayas, for a thorough review of the international law of genocide as it could relate to the Armenian case. We are going to start first with maybe some discussion among the participants here of this conference, and then we'll take questions. The goal is to end at around 4:35 or 4:40, another 20 minutes to clean the room, put the chairs in their place and so on, and then we'll call it a day. I will actually, in this case, start by raising some questions as a way of launching the conversation, but don't feel at all limited to anything. My first question, and it is awkward to have to deal with a talk in the absence of the person who talked. You know, it's very ugly and I don't like it. But we are dealing with an international lawyer, private international lawyer, and naturally there are differences between disciplines and so on. I happen to be also an Ottomanist teaching Ottoman history and modern Turkish history. One of the characteristics of modern Turkey is the fact that first, it doesn't have international pressure to recognize the genocide by the major powers, I mean. The fact that it's recognized by Argentina or Uruguay, you can imagine, you know, is not exactly what frightens Mr. Erdogan. Okay. The second characteristic, of course, this is not apartheid in South Africa or the Holocaust in Germany with a country that is occupied for 30 years by Western powers, a country whose archives are seized, you know, thoroughly combed up to the last detail, you know, okay? So we are talking about a totally different case here, and the case in which I have trouble seeing how that country can even consider the possibility of mediation, because you see, the problem is that there isn't a shred of feeling of guilt in Turkey. To the contrary, a history has been constructed over the past 90 years to the effect that the real injustice is the suffering of the Turkish people, not the Armenians. We have suffered, we have been neglected. And these people want us to recognize their marginal suffering? No. This is ridiculous, they are saying. Okay. When will the genocide of Muslim Turks be recognized by the Europeans? This is what you find if you read Turkish and follow Turkish historiography. In this context, I am rather skeptical about the idea of mediation and open discussion. That's an opinion, and I wish Professor Kesejan were here, because we cannot get a reply. The second thing I can notice in this type of the transitional approach is that it seems to me there is a subtext, and my colleagues who are international lawyers can discuss that or may wish to address it if they so feel. The idea, it seems to me, is that there is no real legal recourse in international law. And thus, we have to adopt, you know, a second path, okay, outside the UN, the International Criminal Court, and anything else, a kind of soft attempt at resolving the problem. It seems to me that is a subtext of this type of approach. And again, this is again unfair, but I like real academic debate. So if we don't discuss issues, there is no point in organizing a conference. I wish Professor Kesejan were here, and I will send her the tape of this conference so that if she has answers, you know, we might be able to integrate them later on in a publication. So I don't want to do this behind her back. Okay? Is it true there is no recourse whatsoever to any court anywhere regarding this matter, and we have to go through a long process of getting acquainted with one another, memorial laws if they happen here and there, and then maybe one day, inshallah, some kind of mediation in the context of a government in Turkey that wishes to go to take that path. This having been said, I want to turn to Professor Desaias's lecture. And you have presented many, many reasons why the Armenian genocide is relevant. Could you tell us in practical terms, in a very short way, today, with all those laws on paper, what can Armenians do, or the Armenian state for that matter? Maybe there is a difference between the state doing it and individuals doing it, or organizations. Is there a court to which they can go and with evidence say, this is what we have suffered, what can you do? You know? Okay? And I am not a naive person. I don't assume that even the court arbitrates in favor of the Armenians. You know, Turkey will comply and so on. That's not what I am saying. But is there a clear body to which Armenians can address their grievances with the adequate evidence?
Well, as you know, there have been a number of successful litigations in the United States against New York Life in order to obtain the proceeds, individual level. Now, as far as, say, a claim for an international wrongful act committed by Turkey against the people of Armenia, you can always go to the International Court of Justice if both states want it. But it's quite clear that Turkey is not ready to submit itself to any kind of international adjudication. The International Criminal Court obviously has no jurisdiction because, according to Article 11 of the Statute of Rome, it is not retroactive, so the International Criminal Court only has competence to address issues whatever happened after 1st July 2002, the entry into force of the Statute of Rome. There is, in my book, on the Armenian Genocide and the relevance of the Genocide Convention, there are two proposals. They may sound a bit far-fetched, but they are theoretically possible. To wit, the all states parties to the Genocide Convention have agreed that any kind of dispute as to the scope of the convention, the application of the convention, the meaning of genocide, etc., if there's a dispute between two states' bodies, that dispute is to be addressed by the International Court of Justice and to be decided by the International Court of Justice. And it's the International Court of Justice that decides whether it has jurisdiction or not. So I could see a case just asking the International Court of Justice, was the Armenian genocide genocide? Does the definition of genocide in the Genocide Convention apply? And I would imagine that the International Court of Justice could very well take the case. Now, this is a double-edged sword. You could have the problem of because let's face it, the 15 judges in the International Court of Justice are not, shall we say, neutral. They are very prominent international lawyers, but you could find yourself with a decision that you would be unhappy about. I mean, there are any number of judgments of the International Court of Justice that I consider to be wrong, but you get a decision. You have eight judges on one side and seven judges on the other. It's like in the Supreme Court of the United States. The best lawyers in the world sitting in the United States Supreme Court, and many decisions go 5-4.
So you have that risk. Yeah.
Please excuse me, I'm interrupting you. But I wanted to ask you, because most of us are certainly not international law specialists here, to go to the International Court of Justice, does that require the Armenian state to do
any
so?
Any state party to the genocide.
Party, but not
it can
an
be
organization.
The United States, it can be France, any state party to the Genocide Convention. And before you give the floor to Professor Sir, I wanted to say, since we're talking about the ICJ, the other possibility would be for the General Assembly to ask for an advisory opinion under Article 96 of the statute, of the UN Charter, and then the ICJ could or could not decide to exercise jurisdiction, and then pursuant to Article 65 of the statute of the ICJ, they could issue an advisory opinion. But there again, the danger is that you might find yourself with an advisory opinion or with a judgment that you are not happy about.
Let's see what Professor Hsu has to say about this.
Well, I would have a lot of remarks about your intervention, but maybe I would at this time just limit myself to that matter of International Court of Justice. I must first say that I disagree profoundly with you when you say that International Court of Justice could be wrong. As I am currently ad hoc judge at the International Court of Justice, I must confess that I find all the judgments and advisory opinions very fine. The matter of knowing whether there is a genocide or not is not exactly a matter of legal dispute in the sense of legal dispute between states. You recall the decision of 63 in the Cameroon Septentrional decision. What is the point? It's an abstract matter. So I agree with you that the General Assembly could, or even the Security Council, could ask the International Court of Justice to give an advisory opinion. That's absolutely right. And that would be a good way, maybe, to settle the matter. But for that, it would mean that two-thirds of member states of the UN would agree that there is a genocide in Armenia. I am not sure it's a fact. It's a fact by now. So I think the way for the time being, maybe later, but for the time being, that way is not open, in my view. And as far as legal disputes are concerned, independently of the fact that in my view, it's not a legal dispute in the sense of the court. There is also the fact that you can have reservations about the competence of the court. You recall that there is an advisory opinion on that, opinion about reservations, precisely in relation with the Genocide Convention. So I don't know what Turkey has done.
I don't believe it has a reservation. It would look bad for Turkey to have done that. And well, I think I checked it years ago and they didn't have one, no?
I don't know. That's a matter of knowledge. And I don't know what is the status of reservations from Armenia as well, mm-hmm. or of Turkey in that respect.
If I may, taking advantage of the presence of prominent international lawyers, years ago, it was, I believe, Raymond, in the probably the 80s or late 70s, there was a scandal problem in the subcommittee or subcommission of human rights led by Mr. Whitaker, I believe, about...
Whitaker was fine. The scandal was just before Whitaker.
The previous fellow who was from one African country.
Rwanda.
Rwanda, yes. about a relatively innocuous document where they were listing the genocides, you know, that had taken place.
It's all described there.
And that's right. I remember this one. I have it. And I believe finally that it was the Armenian case was referred to as a genocide, if I am not wrong.
In the document.
In the
of
document.
The, but that's soft law.
That's soft law. So could you explain to us these things? Because for us ignorant little human beings, you know, soft law, hard law, all that is a little bit tricky. That's why I wanted to know why we have to go to the general, you know, United Nations Assembly, you know, to get an adjudication about whether it's genocide or not.
Yes, soft law is wishful thinking. You would like to see that rule in force. But in fact, by definition, it means that it is not. When you have soft law, it means you have no commitment. So in a way, it's a manner of undermining law to use soft law. Because if you use soft law, it means, okay, there is no law. We would like to get some law. In this respect, silence maybe is better than to pretend that soft law exists.
I don't know. I have a different point of view. Sometimes I consider that soft law is harder than hard law. Take hard law in the
your
form
dreams.
Of take hard law in the form of resolutions of the Security Council. How many resolutions of the Security Council concerning Turkey in the case of Cyprus or concerning Israel in the case of Palestine have been implemented? None. So the fact is that this kind of hard law has no follow-up. Whereas if soft law represents the consensus of the international community, if you have a very large part of international community saying this is what it is, then you've paved the way, this political will, in order to get some advance. Because in order to make Turkey cooperate, all you need is to apply economic sanctions. If the Europeans tell the Turkish people, unless you recognize the Armenian genocide and you give back the properties, you have no chance in the world of entering the European Union.
Yeah.
Unless you play the game and you play the rules and you respect the European Court of Human Rights, you have no chance to enter the European Union. I'd be surprised if the Turks would not gradually do what they had to do.
Okay. It means if, and soft law is precisely if, conditionally. There is absolutely no commitment. And I can't agree with you when you say that the resolution of the Security Council are hard law. Because in the case of Turkey, to my knowledge, it was not under Chapter 7. And it's only decisions of the Security Council which are binding for all member states. Otherwise, that's recommendations, which are not binding, which precisely are soft law.
No, it was under Article 6 in the case of 242 in the case of Israel, but in the case of Turkish, there were articles, Chapter 7. I'm convinced that the resolutions were under Chapter 7 for Turkey, not for Israel.
I will see with pleasure the resolution in cause. But I agree with you with the First Amendment. It's a pillar of democracy on free speech, and I cannot be more supportive of that. So we agree on that. We agree to disagree. but it would be interesting to hear you about the retroactivity of the Genocide Convention. Maybe I could be convinced, but I am not convinced that there is any retroactivity. Even in the Sèvres Treaty, there is no mention of any kind of genocide, but crimes of war and massacre, which is a different
concept.
The word
didn't exist. If
it didn't exist, it cannot be retroactive.
Oh. I'm afraid that you're too much of a positivist. The claims
of the
Armenians.
Yes, I know that you have claimed that, that natural law is above positive law. Well, how could you tell that? Natural law is a pure fantasy.
No.
It has absolutely no obligation for anybody.
The statute of the Nuremberg trials was based primarily on ex post facto legislation. It was a
classical
example.
But it was a legislation.
Example.
It
but
was
it was legislation.
And it was retroactive. So,
you have only one case, it's Nuremberg.
Oh, no, you also have the Nuremberg, Tokyo,
yes.
The statute.
Same thing, Nuremberg and Tokyo.
No,
that's
the statute of Yugoslavia, the statute of Sierra Leone, the statute of Rwanda.
No, Yugoslavia is different. Yugoslavia, it's not the law which is retroactive. It's the competence of the jurisdiction, which is not the same thing.
Depending how you look at it.
No, it is not contested that it was crimes of war or eventually crimes against humanity. But what was retroactive was the competence of the jurisdiction. That's fairly different. And the principle of non-retroactivity of criminal law applies only to the rules of substance.
No, but I understand your point, but I disagree also. I disagree with it.
If I may play the role, we are coming there, you know?
Mediator.
Yes, mediator and troublemaker also. So. We have understood that Professor Desaias is like me, a Taoist. He believes that what is soft is stronger than what is hard. I follow. Yeah. That's right. Yes, that's in judo also, that's true. Now, I had the two questions. Let's leave the issue of genocide out. The world didn't exist. The reality, let's assume, is dubious and so on. Okay. We have on record the reference to the Armenian events as crime against humanity and as massacres and war crimes. Okay. Now, war crime, there were the Hague conventions, I believe. I tried to read a few things, you know, a few years ago when I got concerned by these issues and rather skeptical about the fantasies of some Armenian parties. On the basis of these concepts that existed at that time within the context of the events in 1915, 16, 17, war crime, crime against humanity, massacres, okay? Not going to 1949, the Genocide Convention. Is there any recourse within that context with these categories in question?
Well, the category
second
of...
Point, second yeah. point, and to and then I will shut up forever. Raymond Kevorkian presented a paper with, for example, just on one aspect, you know, the national properties, okay? We saw the massive spoliation, which can be easily documented. Is there any recourse right now in international law from that perspective for the Armenian Patriarchate or the Armenian government, assuming it might wish such a thing, I have doubts, for Armenian organizations to try to put that issue in an international court. That is, that there are 2,400, I don't know how many churches, monasteries that have been outright expropriated, spoliated, either destroyed or seized, and we want them back. Is there any step that can be taken, even if that step were ineffective in Boto at the very end, non-enforceable, but at least there would be something on record that they have been taken over. So these are the two issues that I would like to put on the table, if you don't mind. And you'll excuse me if they look ridiculous for an international lawyer.
No, you are perfectly right. I think in the Lausanne Treaty, Article 42, you have provisions regarding the future of churches, monasteries, cemeteries, and so on. And there is a provision in Article 42 imposing to Turkey to maintain it. And apparently it has not respected that commitment. But there is nothing about the restitution or the reparation for the damages which were before the entry into force of this treaty. So as far as reparation for former damages are at stake, I think the only way would be the Turkish law. And eventually actions
yes.
between Turkish jurisdictions. And it's a principle of Turkish law the equality of all citizens. So they could claim a protection, reparation, on the same basis as any other Turkish person, the Turkish individual. As far as the implementation of the Article 42 is concerned for the future, meaning the destructions being committed in the last 50 years, for instance. In my view, it could be possible to have a claim if the Turkish jurisdiction were not willing to act before the European Court of Human Rights, because it's part of the human rights. I don't know whether it was done or not, but there is a judicial way with that. And otherwise, it could be a legal dispute between Armenia and between Turkey if the two countries were agreeing to submit their dispute to the International Court of Justice or to arbitration. That could be possible. But if it was the case, it would be an international responsibility, international liability, international reparation, and the individuals have nothing to do with that. International responsibility regards the relationship between the states and not the individuals. After that, if, by hypothesis, Armenia succeeded, it could be possible for Armenia to give back some money or other reparations to Armenian people. But only if Armenia was deciding so. International law knows only the states. So don't make a we should not make a confusion between international responsibility between states, among states, and individual claims, which have first to be presented to national jurisdictions and then eventually to the European Court of Human Rights.
Well, but under the principle of protection, say, same as Israel exercised the principle of protection in on behalf of its citizen, Israel did not even exist at the time of the Holocaust. In the case of the Armenian victims, nothing would stop the Armenian state from representing diplomatically the rights of its citizens and trying on behalf of its citizens to make a claim. Absolutely. Now, the problem remains that unlike, say, Germany and Italy that are fighting it out in at The Hague right now, unlike that situation, we both know that Turkey is not going to agree to an adjudication by the International Court of Justice. That is why I said that you have the option, because Article 8 says very clearly that of the Genocide Convention, that in case of a dispute about the convention, the venue is the ICJ. So if Armenia or any other state party to the Genocide Convention wants to test this matter, could say, look, you know, what is the scope of the convention? Does it apply to this case? It's a possibility. It's never been tried. But as I said, there is a danger, whereas you think that it's going to go one way. I mean, I was very surprised with the advisory opinion of the ICJ in the case of Kosovo, that they interpreted the question referred to them by the General Assembly in such a super narrow manner that it really didn't make any sense. It was a thoroughly useless advisory opinion that did not answer the question, because the question essentially was secession legal in that context, and not whether just the declaration was compatible with international law at the time.
Yeah, but it was the way the question, the matter was raised before the International Court of Justice. And you know what happens in the International Court of Justice when you have such a question. It's a difficulty for the court. And the court is looking for an escape way. Because the first objective of the court is to protect itself. So
no.
it cannot refuse to answer. It's difficult. If General Assembly asks you a legal question, you must reply. But you must reply in a manner that doesn't put the court at risk. And you had the same situation with the 96 consultative opinion on use of nuclear weapons. It was, you know, a kind of escape way. It's difficult. We cannot finally decide whether international law prohibits or not the use of nuclear
weapons. Well, the initial use, yes, is just the second question.
Not at all. Initial use is not prohibited because what states the advisory opinion is the court cannot decide whether international law prohibits the use of nuclear weapon in a case of extreme self-defense when the very survival of the country is at stake. It could be at stake.
Well, I discussed that with Judge Koroma and I adhere to his individual opinion.
Another remark. He will have a lot of time because after that we will stop. I have maybe missed something in Catherine Kessett-Jean's intervention, but I have not heard, maybe by my fault, reference to the restitution of Jewish properties in France. Restitution by the state or by private persons, eventually, of Jewish properties resulting from spoliations during the war. There is a French legislation and there is a process of restitution and it's effective. But it's only a domestic legislation. So I think in Turkey towards Armenians or towards people from Armenian origin, Turkish people from Armenian origin, it would be the same. It had to be a domestic legislation.
Je voudrais apporter quelques références historiques à votre réflexion. Les juristes connaissent assez mal les travaux d'une sous-commission qui travaillait pour la commission des réparations, pour les préparatifs de la conférence de la paix. Oui, 1919 même, de février à avril 1919. On a épluché ces archives qui sont à Paris. Et ce qui est assez révélateur, c'est que les conclusions de cette commission de juristes internationaux, vous les connaissez, Jacquemin, etc., 80% des éléments de cette conclusion se trouvent dans la convention de 48 sur les génocides. Il faut le signaler. C'est la première catégorisation, en fait, des crimes de ce type.
Pardon, pas quoi. Dr. Kevorkian has done some work with some other people on the documents preparing the peace conferences. And he mentions that there was a subcommission dealing with legal matters pertaining to the issue of reparations in particular. And that subcommission in 1918-19, we are talking about that period and the peace conference of that time. And he argues that about 80% of the legal findings of that subcommission were subsequently adopted in 1948-9 in the Genocide Convention or what?
C'est repris dans la convention de 48 sur le génocide.
In the Genocide Convention. So there is a legal foundation, apparently, that started historical. At that time. Historical foundation.
Historical, but not legal.
Historical, but not legal, says Professor Sur. Any other comment?
Donc, qu'est-ce qu'on on lit concrètement? Déplacement forcé de population, enlèvement de personnes civiles, confiscation de biens. Il y a toute la liste. Elle est là, en place, et cerise sur le gâteau, on propose la création d'un tribunal international pour punir ces nouveaux crimes. C'est les termes.
All the elements of the exactions that occurred during the genocide, kidnappings, killings, and so on, are mentioned, and there is even the mention of the necessity of creating an international criminal court already at that time in 1919. So these are historical references.
Yeah,
history.
Very legal, but not legal.
Yeah, I wanted to say that both, that I agree both with Professor Sir and with Professor Asturian on the issue of the use and the possibilities of using national law in Turkey, exhausting domestic remedies in Turkey.
Absolutely.
And if one doesn't get redress in Turkey, one can go either to the European Court of Human Rights or to the Human Rights Committee. Now,
let me ask you something again, because I know the audience has to follow, and then we'll I'll allow two or three members of the audience to ask questions. And that will be it for today. Could, for example, the Patriarchate of Istanbul start a lawsuit within Turkey? No, these are, you know, they are Turks, Turkish citizens. You cannot be a patriarch if you are not a Turkish citizen. Right. Okay, as a Turkish citizen, on the basis of egality, equality, and if there are games in the legal system in Turkey, then go to the European Court. Can that happen?
Well, the problem is the statute of limitations. I am persuaded that there are statute of limitations for when you can submit that kind of a case, and that must have expired decades and decades ago in Turkey. So that is the problem with using national legislation. That's why, you see, Germany adopted specific legislation, so did Austria, in order to allow the reception of that kind of a claim. Turkey doesn't want to have that kind of a claim. So the problem that the Armenians are facing is a problem of basically public opinion. When there's a public opinion in international society and in Turkey, within Turkey, that they want to do this because the Germans want to make amends, that is the great difference. The Germans are repentant. The Germans are ashamed of what happened in the name of Germany, and they have the willingness to make it possible for the victims to get redress. That is not the case in Turkey. Turkey is totally in denial and is blocking. So the way to get at them, for instance, is through the examination of the state reports and embarrass them in public, naming and shaming, and in the UPR, in the system of the Universal Periodic Review of the Human Rights Council, once again, in public session, embarrassing them and bringing all the facts until, I mean, even if it's only soft law, what the Human Rights Council is going to tell Turkey to do, even if the concluding observations of the Human Rights Committee are only soft law, but I assure you, that the Human Rights Committee, if the Armenians play their cards correctly, if the Armenians go there, if the Armenians make sure that questions are added to the questionnaire, and the Armenians are there to brief members of the Human Rights Committee before the examination of the report in July 2012, then in the concluding observations, that will be picked up. Because it's one of the biggest issues.
Yes, I think the Armenians were not even aware of that, probably. Whatever the case might be, we are going to take two questions and we have to finish this session. Sir, you have questions, not lengthy comments, please.
I would like to... Am I on?
Yeah.
Okay, I would like to follow up the Professor Desire's comments regarding ICJ and the risk that Armenians may take by going there and get a ruling against them, all right? But I do think that there is also an equally important risk, and that is that Turkey may go to ICJ and get a ruling just short of the G, and they're happy and they go home, and Armenians are blocked up forever because that's not appealable. And therefore, I do think that the Armenians should be very, very proactive as far as preparing themselves and going to ICJ and preempt that, and that is quite possible that it may happen before 2015.
Can I say something? The G word, of course, has a certain magic to it. I mean, the G word is powerful. On the other hand, as far as the legal consequences, I mean, the obligation to make reparation and the non-applicability of statutes of limitation to matters of genocide and crimes against humanity, whether the Armenian genocide is considered in the category of genocide or in the category of crimes against humanity, at the end of the day, you have the same legal results. The added value of the G word is that it is the most horrendous of crimes. I mean, you are imposing the odium of having perpetrated genocide on Turkey. And in that sense, because of the image, it's more powerful. But it would not be necessary in order to get reparation to make a finding that you have genocide. And as I said, and I explained that in my book, it is a red herring and it's the wrong question. It's not necessary to answer the question whether the Genocide Convention applies retroactively, because the main issue is that the claims, the rights of the Armenians were not created by the Genocide Convention, but pre-existed. And they were already recognized in Article 144 and in Article 230 of the Treaty of Sèvres. The problem is that by posing the question that way, and there's a good deal of bad faith involved in this, people say, well, you know, what a pity, it just doesn't quite go over the threshold of genocide. And well, since it wasn't genocide, then it wasn't all that bad.
Yeah.
And too bad, you're getting nothing. So that kind of approach, unfortunately, is rather répandu. It's rather...
I think we are going to move to the next question and then a final one, and that will be it. Yes, sir.
It's a follow-up from the gentleman who just spoke. There is a very close analogy, which is Ireland's dealings with Britain.
Mm-hmm.
And in that case, it wasn't genocide that the Irish decided to sue the British for. It was actually torture. And we did a lot of the steps which are being proposed here, the European Court of Human Rights. And the European Court of Human Rights found that indeed the British did practice torture. However, the British appealed to the European Court. And there were horrendous consequences of this. So the European Court actually allowed torture effectively to be defined practically out of existence. And so torture actually became the loss of a limb. And that is actually, the result of that is the British were able to claim that they weren't practicing torture. And that in the late 70s is actually the foundation of the You and Bybee torture memos. And the lawyer who took the case for the Irish government is a gentleman called Pat Finucane, who was actually, he was assassinated by the British 11 years later. His brother spoke here a few weeks back. So with respect to the legal route, it actually is fraught with danger. And I think that indeed should be emphasized.
It is ironic that I was finishing reading a book by, what's his name, Dylan, Matt Dylan, on the Dirty War. And
yeah.
Mr. Finucane is mentioned in it. But I will let my colleagues in international law to comment if they wish to comment. No?
Well, there's always a danger. And I explain it in my book on the Armenian genocide. You can always end up on the wrong side. That is, you can have a decision 8-7 against you. And the argumentation of the 7 might be enormously superior to that of the 8. But you still lost. And that happens in the US Supreme Court, where all the Supreme Court justices come from Harvard, Yale, Berkeley. You would think that they would all agree and they would all interpret international law in the same way, or rather interpret national law, the U.S. Constitution, in the same way, and they don't. So, you know, sometimes you learn a hell of a lot by reading the individual opinions or the dissenting opinions of the judges. As I said, in the nuclear case, I love the individual opinion of the Sierra Leone judge, Coroma. In any event, even if you were to lose it, you would gain it. Why? Because the main problem of the Armenians has been this crime of silence. And that's the name of the Tribunal Permanent du Peuple that held in 1984 this famous meeting in Paris with my old boss, Theo van Boven, and all these wonderful people who participated in it. The main problem of the Armenians is that, as Hitler said, nobody cares. Nobody knows anything about it. So if you have a case in the International Court of Justice,
Professor,
at least
Desires, you get
a lot of publicity.
I don't mean to be disrespectful, but we have to finish this because we have responsibilities toward other people who are waiting also. Dr. Seraidarian, that's the last question.
Yes, thank you. My question probably would be almost a crime in the eyes of some people. Is it absolutely necessary that we link the right of the Armenians of the Ottoman Empire or their descendants to link it only to the word genocide? Is that absolutely necessary? Probably not.
No. Decidedly not.
No.
Crime against humanity suffices.
No, I have in front of me, I opened the page on the Ministry of Foreign Affairs site of the Turkey. And where you, when you type there the word Armenian genocide, there is a whole document in it from the Turkish point of view. I'm just looking at it now. According to the statistics provided in that document of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs with a nice picture of Mr. Ahmed Davutoglu on it, there were 800,000, what they called Gregorian Armenian population, excluding Istanbul, it's not there because it's by Vilayet, and excluding, of course, Kars, which was occupied by Russia, if you want, Eastern Armenia. So that, but they, in these statistics, they show 800,000 Gregorian Armenians. The Patriarchate in Istanbul counts in the Gregorian Church, and I can stand to be corrected by Kevorkian, 1.3 million. If you add to it the Armenian Protestants and Catholics, it comes to 2 million, something like that. Okay? About 2 million people. So that it means that we are talking now about only an argument about statistics. There were people, Armenians, there for centuries. They are not. The question is, why do we have to link it always to the question of genocide? Because this same document says they deported, they don't use the word deported, they said relocated 700,000 people. It is during the relocation that many people died, not in, by killing in the villages. Now, if we continue to insist that continuously it is the genocide, it means that we are getting ourselves into a corner. Or am I wrong? I mean, isn't there a right for claims and restitution independently, whether something is called genocide or a crime against humanity? People who do not exist anymore, who lost their nationalities, either survived under nonsense passports or were killed. And we became French and American and Canadian and God knows what.
No, genocide is not absolutely necessary in my view. But the problem is with genocide, you have imprescriptibility. Imprescriptibility. And with ordinary crimes, if I may say so, you have a prescription in most of criminal legal systems in states, within states. So it would preclude actions coming very late. But that's a matter of Turkish law. You can always reopen some matters. And for instance, with the French law on restitution of Jewish properties, it was a specific law. So it's always possible. But if you look at the criminal approach, the benefit of genocide is the imprescriptibility, as well as crimes against humanity. But what are the crimes against humanity except of genocide? Because genocide is a perfect example in the diamond, if I may say so, of crime against humanity. But I don't know what could be the crimes against humanity apart from genocide.
Well, the definition, both according to the Nuremberg Statute and according to the Statute of Rome, includes deportation. It includes killings. It includes the kind of disappearances, the kind of humiliating treatment to which these people were subjected. There is an overlapping of the concepts of war crimes and crimes against humanity. If you look at Article 6B and 6C of the Nuremberg Statute. But in any event, it would suffice to have the same kind of restitution and reparation under the rubric crimes against humanity. And the added value of the G word is that it is universally recognized as the crime of crimes. And you want to impose the odium of it on the perpetrators.
Yeah, but in the case of Armenia, the qualification of genocide is not universally recognized. That's the point.
I would like to know from the Armenians how many states have, because I mean, there have been enormous numbers of parliaments that have already recognized it. I mean, whether it be Canada or it be many states of the United States that have already officially recognized it. Even though Obama hasn't recognized it, but there's a considerable number of states, and it's growing and it's growing and it's growing.
Obama has recognized?
No, has not. Has
no.
Not.
Yes, no.
No. No. He used the word. He used the word in Armenian. He called it Mezia. There was a big uproar in the Armenian community saying he should have used the word genocide.
You know, I have a problem with this business of endless recognition. So far as I'm concerned, the most important thing is that I recognize it as genocide. Let's assume 110. Let's assume 110 countries in the world recognize it as genocide, and the Turkey doesn't. What does that change?
Well, that's my question.
Of course, there are the International Association of Genocide Scholars has recognized it, many other organizations, but that's not legal.
I've always thought they were. Can you address that?
What is the legal consequence of
a private association making recognition of that? It doesn't mean anything at the international legal level. No, if you had a majority of states, a huge majority, it would allow to ask a question to the International Court of Justice. And if a majority of states were recognizing, well, the court is prudent, is cautious. Otherwise, it could be possible to take sanctions. You would have a legal basis for sanctions and a political one. But for the time being, you have a legal uncertainty and a political basis which is rather fragile.
Well, I think it's time to end this symposium, all the more so since I think with the genocide issue, I can feel it in the air, that feeling has started replacing cold-blooded reason, which is exactly what we wanted for this conference. I feel excitement, looks, comments right and left, you know. So it's time to stop the whole thing. I would like to thank you for coming. I am extremely grateful to the participants, some of whom
had to change their schedule, postpone things to be able to be here. You saw Professor Karamanian, who arrived yesterday and left today immediately. I am very appreciative of their efforts and of the papers they have presented. We are going by next year to publish the proceedings of this conference, the texts, and we will be webcasting an edited version of this conference once the whole thing is ready. So thank you for coming, and especially thanks to my colleagues, Professor Sur, Kevorkian, Desayas, and Karamanian, and Professor Kesejian from afar for sharing their opinion with us.